Okay, our next speaker is from Munich. His name is Bernd Paysan. I'm a French, I have to pronounce it the French way. Paysan, I suppose you say that in German.
Normally, I pronounce it in French as well.
Okay. He's going to present his own project of a shared cloud environment, if I correct.
A peer-to-peer.
Okay, so please, let's have a big hand for Mr. Bernd Paysan from Munich.
Okay, my talk is called Cloudcalypse. It looks like you have reached the end. That is a meme coming from Google Plus shutting down, and then they had some hiccups right after the announcement. When you load the Google Plus page, you got an empty page, and it said it looked like you have reached the end. So that's what will be true in April. You really have reached the end on Google Plus, and you've reached the end on other clouds as well. So what I'm talking about is now what to do with your data. And I want to say one thing about this cloudocalypse that is very commonly used for this kind of problem in the clouds. That is very bad Greek, because apocalypse means uncovering. It does not mean any catastrophic, it's just uncovering. And so what we really mean when we want to say it in Greek is a synepho catastrophe. Synepho is cloud, and catastrophe, you know what it is, that made it into English as well. So cloudcalypse is very bad Greek, but it has been translated into cloud, I suppose. So that's how it's going on. So this is a pretty dark picture. There's a tornado and the lightning, and the people in the cloud are here in a farmland. They're probably playing Farmville in their cloud in Facebook or so. So the tornado creates a lot of chaos. And what do you do? So let's talk about why I'm motivated to do this thing. Now, the internet is a bad gateway. We have a lot of trouble in the internet. Let's see what we have, kind of political problems 5 years after Snowden. We have this EU parliament. They did upload filters, link taxes, and of course they want the upload filters to use to filter terrorist contents. I don't know what terrorist contents is, but they seem to know. And the Germany wants a cyber administration like the Chinese CAC, or CAC, as we often say. That is a Medienstaatsvertrag. If you publish something on the internet, you are treated like a TV broadcaster, and that means you have to go through many bureaucratic hoops. That will be a problem if they really do it. And we have all these requests for backdoors. Please backdoor here, backdoor there, backdoor in 5G, backdoor in any chat program, whatever. We have a progress on the political side. The ECHR rules that the GCHQ Dragnet surveillance actually violates your right. And my project, Net2O, becomes more and more usable. And still not finished, still not polished, still not perfect, but the top layer is going on. So what is a cloudcalypse or cloudocalypse? What goes wrong? So clouds are failing. Here you see a bubble diagram of world's biggest data breaches and hacks inside the clouds, and this one starts about 2010, and there were little failures, and it became bigger, and now you have each of the big bubbles is about 500 million of people affected. So yes, the cloud looks darker and is falling apart. What kind of cloud failing events did we have last year? Something like Microsoft bought GitHub, so it's not failing, but it's now owned by someone we don't like, or many people don't like. That one was easy. You can install GitLab and Dropbox dropped the Linux client except for X4 unencrypted, and the explanation is somehow weak. If you don't know that Condoleezza Rice is in Dropbox management, you maybe think they are stupid, but I don't think they are stupid. This is on purpose. Facebook had so many scandals that I have a literature link. Heise made a special look back onto the Facebook scandals. The year in Facebook was very terrible. Google Plus had some similar problems in their APIs that affected both users, so, and they are now shutting it down. One of the users was me, and so I thought, what to do with my data? So that started this sub-project of Net2O. Tumblr deleted all porn, which means there's now 1% left of the contents of Tumblr. And yeah, the last one is what I just made up. You can't date on Tinder anymore because dating violates Facebook policy. So the second part is correct. Tinder uses Facebook login, so they have to somehow get over that. On Facebook, it's not allowed to date. So when you use the Facebook login to go to Tinder and share your Facebook account, and so it's probably also not allowed. So, and the purpose of Tinder, of course, is not to share cat photos, if you have any questions about that. So, what are the root causes of this cloud's failing? One root cause is that the ad-based revenue model is toxic inherently. I will come to that next slide. The next root cause is the user plus password authentication. That is all these data breaches. It just doesn't work. People pick 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 as password, so, and they will continue to do so. This doesn't work. And the main root cause is your data is on someone else's computer, not on your own computer. It's not under your control. And it's under control of a big company, or as we see in a federated system, under a small company or a small person, is the same problem on different scale. So why is the ad-based revenue model, why is it toxic? So they have, first of all, they have the incentive to keep you on the site. And they do that by XKCD3H6. Are you coming to bed? I can't, this is important. What? Somebody is wrong on the internet. So when you have a controversial discussion, you will be engaged, you will answer that, you will comment, you will write back and forth, and that will keep you on the site. So that's why you don't have the dislike, because otherwise, if you have a controversial discussion, you just hit the dislike button and forget about it, but now you have to comment if you dislike that thing. And the incentive is also to make you easy target of manipulation, because that what they sell is their ads, and that's the worst fake news they have. The ads don't tell you the truth. The ads want to manipulate it to buy something. And they want to get a lot of information about you because they think then they can sell the ads at a higher price, because targeted ads are more expensive than untargeted ads, and so they want to know everything about you to meet their creepy business model. Make you post about your private things. Not the Tumblr and Tinder way, but not the private parts, the private things. The things they don't know about you easily. And yeah, the participants on this kind of social networks also think, yeah, it's a good idea if the people are already weak and easy to influence, I become influencer and make a lot of money. So all this drags the entire social network scene into this ad-based business. When you go on YouTube, you have a lot of influencers. Maybe you don't, because you go to YouTube to see Chaos Computer videos, but you don't, please don't go to YouTube. Go to the CCC Media Center. And you should be aware that this is nothing new, the problem. This is in TV, in journal, this is very old, the problem. So every newspaper wants to do the same thing with you. So we see the centralized has problems. It has its good parts, because centralized means there's good funding, there's robust hardware, there's a lot of protection against attacks. And yeah, the downside is you give away your privacy. It's a honeypot for everybody who wants to get 1 billion password combinations. It's captive because it wants to suck you in. And when it's not generating enough revenues, the CEO just will shut it down, and all the time you invested in it, all the contents is going away. And yeah, there is a censorship problem. All these big powers want to censor something. So here in the West, we have copyright-based censors because our power is the people who own things. In the Far East, there is political censorship because their political still is more powerful. And then you have all this weird nibble censorship with some religious issues. And you have this toxic business model that is bad on the centralized. You can go federated. Let's say you leave Google Plus for diaspora. Many people do so. And it has the big advantage. It's not actually captive because the small business operating this diaspora server is cheap and they don't really need a lot of money to do so. I think the Pluspora people told us you need about 2 cents per month and user to operate such a thing. So it's really cheap. The censorship becomes more regionally. So in parts of the world, for example, in Japan, Lolicon is okay. Lolicon is a dropout of a previous censorship on porn. And the Japanese government said, okay, we messed this up, so we don't censor again because that will move the people to more weird fetishes. And just allow it. This is all fiction. It's just images painted by some artists. Nobody is harmed by these lolicons. But in the rest of the world, this is child porn, especially in German. So the Mastodon nodes, Mastodon got a big surge in from this lolicon community because they use Mastodon to post their stuff. And these are isolated to Japan. So you can't get their feeds on European or American Mastodon servers. So you have blacklisted nodes, you have regional censorship instead of global censorship. You can't do lolicon on Facebook or Twitter or so. That is why they came to Mastodon in the first place. The downside, poor funding, underpowered hardware, and attack protection is also bad because these are operated by small business or by private persons. And the problem of lack of privacy is the same as above because it's all public postings and the end of life is now it's the whim of the node admin of a particular node. So if you sign up on a node that goes down next week, you lose all your data just because there may not be even an announcement to when they shut down. It's just shutting down. So third possibility is peer-to-peer. So you have full control over your own node, and you have pretty good privacy because you can limit who can access you. And funding is mostly development funding because the operating of a peer-to-peer network is very cheap. It's you operate it with your own computer, and you need your own computer anyhow, or your own mobile, whatever. The plus minus side is that peer-to-peer networks cannot really censor. So The plus thing is, yeah, we don't really want censorship. The downside is it attracts the people who are refugees from censorship first. And so maybe the content looks all lolicons, all terrorists, whatever, people fly from the censorships, whatever ugly things are there will come in early. That is actually a problem because that shapes the mental image of such a system to people. So when I want to make this a friendly place, non-existent censorship can be a problem. And also the trolls, the people whose communication pattern is so evil that you cannot really tolerate them. They will come very early as well. They get kicked out of the other places, so they come as refugees. You really need to do this full control of your nodes so you can kick out people you don't like, kick out content you don't like. Therefore, the downside that you have full the upside that you have full control node is mirrored by the downside that you actually have full responsibility for your own node. What you do on your thing, there's nobody helping you. It's you. So, what is about this taking out? Fortunately, we have the Article 20 GDPR. You can now legally take out your own data, and the big cloud providers are obliged to help you. Sometimes they provide something lackluster, and still the situation we still have is not very good, but they have a duty. So if they are too bad on that, you can talk to some official and have that regulated. Put a bit more pressure on that. Taking out your data is important. They want to suck in your data. They have this big tornado to take your data. But to get out, you need help, maybe from the government, finally. So what I'm doing is Net2O. And if you want to start, have a look over this lower six layers or five layers, you best go to the 31.3c talk on my homepage. I'm talking a lot about the technical details here. I'm talking about the app level details, about how to take in your data, not about so much about the packet formats, encrypting, the flow controls, the command language, and the distributed data. Bit about that, because that is needed for implementing Net2O social networks. So today will be mostly 6 and 7 and not the other sticks. So let's start with a takeout. You go to Google Plus was the first thing I wanted to take out. So you on Google, you go to takeout.google.com, settings takeout, and they always localize everything for you, including the file names and the zip, which is awful. But so you select nothing, only the stream data of Google Plus, and then you have to go through. This all is HTML by default. HTML, 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 you have to change that to JSON, because that HTML is not passable, what they produce, very ugly HTML. Please use JSON. The JSON is not perfect, far from perfect, but it's much better than the HTML. So let's look at how does this JSON look like. This is a real posting, and you see here down here they have this weird Unicode escapes for what's this. So I decoded that for you. That is just HTML angular brackets. So what you have is you have some anchor, the URL where you find it on Google Plus until April, and later you won't find it anymore. You have a creation time, you have an update time. Unfortunately, you have no editing history. You have an author, which is always a four tuple, so you have display name, profile page URL, avatar image URL, and the resource name of this posting. are just somehow redundant because the URL has the resource as well, differently encoded, of course, but it's the same thing. And the author, yeah, that is the resource name of the author. That is sometimes plain text. You can ask for your own name there, or you get that number or encoded in something like base 64 or whatever that is. And then you have the content that is very limited HTML because Google Plus does not have so many formatting options. And you have bold, you have some links in there. Let's scroll a bit down. And you have things like link. When you have a link, when you post something, I want to show you this link on the internet, you get the link. And then you have all these plus oneers, the people who liked your postings. They are like the author, all the details are in there, so you have a lot of redundancy inside of this database, the JSON thing. You have to make sure that it's just the same person always. Nope. And here in this part, in this example, we don't have any comments. But normally you have also comments. The comments what are lacking the plus ones. You don't get the data of the plus ones, and the plus ones are lacking the timestamp, so you don't know when the people liked that. That is the details that are lacking that I want to take out, but Google doesn't give me. So let's look at how does the competition do this. If you have Facebook, the timestamps are no longer human readable; they are just seconds, since Unix timestamp seconds. I like that because easy to pass. And yeah, you don't have likes and you have comments here. You have a timestamp for the comment. I don't want to scroll. Don't want to skip. So you have your data description in the post double. In this case, because that's a video. And there's a little, oh, my presentation crashed. Fuck. So let's go back to the Facebook takeout. Then we go to the Twitter takeout. A tweet, you think, is a small thing. It's just 280 characters now, maximum. But they have a very complicated way to describe the things inside the tweet. So when you see the tweet itself, please. The tweet itself is just this full text here. It's very short. But they give you a lot of metadata about that. They say, who is the user ID? What did you reply to? When did you create this? Where exactly is the substring you need to highlight as a hashtag or as a user ID? And what's the screen name of these people? You can make some use of that, so this is not too bad. It just blows up the archive. But Google Plus is much worse with blowing up the archive size. On average, every image you posted there, you get in the takeout 3 times on average. They don't deduplicate these images, they just push them to you 3, maybe 4 times on average. So, and images are big, and people on Google Plus often used to post images because that was the great function Google had done right. And so many photographers went to Google Plus posting a lot of big images, and when they do the takeout, they get the images 3 to 4 times. If you do blogging on Google, Blogger is still alive, but it looks like 10 years ago, so they are not doing anything on their Blogger, and maybe they are shutting down it when they want to. I don't know why they bought it in the first time when they don't do anything new with it, but yeah, that's at Google. So you might want to take your Flogger posting out. It's not JSON, it's an Atom feed, so it's XML. XML is okay. We can pass XML easily. It has a reasonable metadata structure, not too much. I skipped all the actual content, and it says the metadata is okay, so it's not too much. And the content is HTML. You have to deal with HTML. That is not a big problem as well. So what do you need to program for these imports? If you want to import the people into Diaspora, you have to do the same things as I do. So you need a JSON parser, you need an XML parser, and you need an HTML parser, and these are all parts which are either easy to write or in many frameworks you just have them. So you need this schemas for that. You don't want to take anything in, you want to know what you're taking in. And in Net2O you need an HTML to Markdown converter. In Diaspora, same thing, because modern frameworks often use Markdown, don't use HTML. And you need a downloader for the missing parts, because the archive does not really contain everything. But in Google, the avatar photos of all these 1,000 people that commented and plus one all your postings, the avatar photos are not in your takeout, only the screen names. So, but you have the URLs, you can collect them all, and you can download all these avatars. And what you need to do in Net2O particularly, you need to assign a temporary secret key for all those persons, because in Net2O, a person is identified by a key, a pub key. And you don't know, the real person is not importing your data, you are importing the data. So you have to assign a temporary secret key, which you hand over later to the person if they join that network. That is how then does the social network look like is implemented in Net2O. So you have texts as Markdown, no big deal. You have images as JPEG, PNG, no deal at all. You have movies as MKV, WebM, some deal, because all those multimedia streaming APIs like GStreamer or on Android are clumsy and not the way I like them. I want to have OpenGL as backend, so I want the thing to render into a GL texture. That is one of the easier things they can do, so it's not a big problem. If you want to embed it in your browser, you need to hope that the browser supports all this stuff. Usually it does. So that's what you want as data formats. In Net2O, the structure for something which, like a timeline, is a chat log in general. So you have a chat app, you can add entries to your chat log. Chat logs can be synchronized between instances. If you have duplicates, they get deduplicated, they don't get copied. If you add new things, the chat log has a mechanism to spread that out through peer-to-peer network. So that is all there, that is working well. And the timeline just is a chat log with maybe one line of your posting and a link to a DVCS project. DVCS means Distributed Version Control System. So think like Git, but minimized to the features you actually need for simple things. You don't need all this fancy stuff with Git, and it has 100 different commands, and each command has at least 20 different options. No, you don't need that. What you need is patches, diffs, matches, forks, that kind of thing is what you need. And that's what I'm giving you in Netto as well. No need for big things. But small things are very important. You want to edit your posting after you did it, because usually you write your posting, you look through it, you fixed all the typos, then you press send, and then magically a typo appears in the title, right in the first word. And you want to fix that because it looks really like you are stupid. And therefore, you need a version control system. And yeah, so a DVCS project, how is it structured? It's a chat log again, because all this thing is recurring. Now it's a check-in log as the chat log. And each check-in has either a patch set or a snapshot. And now this is not difficult to build that data structure. Now if this actions on your postings, actions is typically actions to reshare. You reshare, you add a message yourself, you put it into your own timeline. So that is a fork of the DVCS project. You add another postings to it, and you put your log message into your own timeline. A comment is the same, but you kind of make a pull request, which is probably handled automatically. So you put the log message into the original project log. And what you can do with that, you can do both, something you can't do on Google+. You can say, OK, I want to write a comment, and I want to reshare that comment. Other social networks have this sort of functions where you have threaded discussions, or they only have the reshare function, something like Twitter, where you have comments and reshares look a bit different, but essentially are the same. It's always a public posting that refers to the original posting. And you probably want to have likes. So the like is a chat log message into the DVCS project without link or anything, just with one character for the thumb up or for plus or what you decided to have as your like, or maybe a dislike as well, because you don't want to have the people to comment on bad postings. That's how it's supposed to be structured. And what's missing now? Because I'm not finished. The shutdown was announced in October, and I wanted to present it here. And I wrote code, but I'm not fully finished. I still have things to do. So the bulk importer for Google+ that is almost finished. That is just not tested with all my 3,000 postings. It's tested with a few important postings where all the challenges are inside. And what I need to write is a bulk importer for the other big things like Facebook, Twitter, Blogger, if you have suggestions, Instagram, maybe Tumblr. That is all not so difficult to write an importer. The formats are relatively easy to deal with. It's only that you have to put all the infrastructure in place that you can bulk import these things. I want to use the avatars to display the user ID. At the moment, I just take screen name. I need a markdown renderer in Net2O, but that what you see here is a presentation using the user interface for Net2O. So actually, there's not much to do here. This markdown is very easy to pass, and the rendering is already in place and works. Album viewer, movie players, that is needs to look nice. If it doesn't look nice, the people will not post your photos on the social networks. That is one of the problems I have with Diaspora. The backend maybe is okay, but the display does not look like Google+ are polished. It needs to be polished if you want to have photographers inside. These are people who think visually, have artist mind and they don't tolerate when it's ugly. They just don't tolerate it. They don't come to you. That is why they didn't come to Facebook. Facebook's album viewer is just ugly. It's too ugly for these people. The key handover to contacts needs to be programmed. The infrastructure is there, but it needs the actual details needs to be programmed. And I need to mark this imported key as non-trustworthy. They are not the original person, not the real person, and all the content that is coming from this person is not authentic. It's coming from Google. They could have messed up with that in any possible way. You don't know. So in Net2O, every comment, every chat message, every posting is signed by the person who did it. It's authentic. That is what a good crypto system does. It ensures authenticity, it ensures your privacy because it's encrypted, it ensures that it's integrity because the hash is correct, and it's authentic that it's really coming by the person who controls the secret key. But here the imported keys is not controlled by the person who owns that posting. So it's not authentic, it's not trustworthy. And I don't have any mechanism for that at the moment because normally in a secure system, you know only the person who has the key can sign it. Here, it's not the case. So, the last part, I'm good in time. The last part is the non-technical problems. The one non-technical problem if you move from one community to another is what to do with your contacts. If you lose them all, you are in this two-user Google Plus style ghost town. Now, Google Plus wasn't really a ghost town, but it didn't have so many people inside. You had to look for them. But when you don't get your contacts over, you are in a ghost town. You're just only you. What's the point of a social network with only one person? No point. So a related problem is how to make social networks nice places. And the ad-based revenue is actually working against that. So they don't want to make it a nice place. They want to make it a place where you are angry enough to reply, but not angry enough to leave. It is a very thin limit. They have to dance on that volcano. And the third non-technical problem is how do I fund Net2O? And at the moment, I fund Net2O by using my technology, especially the user interface technology, to get some contracts, totally unrelated to peer-to-peer networks, but interesting contracts, and maybe I should think of some other way of funding it. I don't know. When a lot of people use it, each person needs to give only very little money to fund it, or maybe only a few persons need to give some money, and most of the people can use it for free. That is the ideal world. I don't want to sell a big thing, because that would give me that toxic kind of business model. So, I'm done. You have literature and links. The most important, at least, the other one, like the XKCD, was embedded in the presentation. When you want to know more about Net2O, you go on my homepage, watch previous videos, read some documentation. If you want to know what these biggest data breaches are really, here is the link. And if you can read German and you want to see how many breaches of those were Facebook only, they had their own timeline. And that's the QR code of my Net2O key in the inverted format because I had to shift to night mode here. With my presentation, all slides dark. Normally that is inverted and the cameras do a better job when everything is bright and not dark. So, we have time for questions and answers.
Well, thank you, Bernd. Wow, thank you. Okay. We still have about 10 more minutes. Sorry, I have to do this because I don't see against the light. Are there any questions? The mics are open.
I think.
Oh, there we are. Speak into the mic. Please go right to it like I'm doing.
It's okay. Yeah. I have one question regarding the security of the node, because you mentioned the security of the big central model. I must rely on the operator. Mm-hmm. On the decentralized, I must rely on the administrator of the pod. But on the small net 2.0,
on the small,
I must rely on my own.
Yeah, that's what I said. It means responsibility, but the attack vector on your side is always there. So if you go to Facebook, to Google+, your own computer can always be hacked. That attack vector does not go magically away because you go to the cloud. So on your side, I have to take care with my implementation that it's robust and secure, and that you can use that as normal person without having a too big attack vector. But the attack vector never goes down to zero. Some evil mate can come in and compromise your laptop, first install a keylogger on the keyboard, and then in the second visit, use that keylogger to extract the password for your hard disk and then decrypt your hard disk and install different programs. That kind of things is totally out of reach for me. That kind of breaches, that is in your responsibility, but that is an attack vector that can be done anyhow. So that is why they have this backdoors, this Trojan horses, the state Trojans they want to install on your laptop, on your smartphones, that kind of thing other people have to fight. That is not communication on the network, that is your device security. And that problem is always persistent. That does not change when you use a big cloud. It just makes it easier with the big cloud, because now you have this big company which has to comply to all kinds of laws when you get an NSL, National Security Letter, Google has to collaborate. They are prison partner, Facebook is prison partner, Twitter is prison partner, Microsoft, Apple, they all have to collaborate. So, but you as a normal person, you don't have to collaborate. They won't ask you. They will break into your computer. Maybe you can do some things to prevent that. Other people may give talks here to help you, but that is out of my reach. And that is not changing when you change from big cloud to small cloud to peer-to-peer. That's not changing.
Thank you.
Yeah, as they say, the network is not secure, but your computer is your business. Yeah.
Yes.
I mean, my device is my job. I have a question. Huh? How big is your crowd until today?
At the moment, this all is still in small development. I have a few testers. We regularly use the chat app to chat with each other. That are 4 to 5 people who are regularly. On my contact list, I have about 30 people who tried it, so it's small. At the moment, it's really small. And to stabilize that, it's okay, because my testers still find bugs and send me reports and keep me busy. And I want organic growth. So I don't want to, the worst nightmare is when I'm ready in April and all of Google+, all 300 million to users come in, that would be too much. So grow slow, get the technology robust and stable, and then grow organically. I don't want to be the fastest growing network in the world. That would be very difficult to handle.
In French, they would call that embarras de richesse, embarrassment of riches.
Yeah.
Okay. Any more questions? The mics are open. No? Well, in this case, as I understand it, you're happy for beta testers, aren't you? Yeah. So if you feel free, there's a stream. You can always, if you don't have your camera with you, you haven't taken it down, mm-hmm. always look at the stream on CCC, yeah. Media CCC.
And I'm on the board, on the table right over there on the corner, just over around here next to the stage. When you have questions to me, you don't want to talk in public, go there, right at the corner with the robot playing and the LED lights, and just there.
Okay, let's have a big hand for Bernd Pézant.